Yeah, we just pondered. Just a second, but YouTube, we have to make another. I think there's something else had to be created. Another link or something. Please.
Should I go on Instagram?
Go on Instagram, sir. He's just going on Instagram. He's already live on YouTube. We can start by 6:05. Oh, go on Instagram also. He's on. All right. 6:05. 3 minutes and we start. No, he loves a perfect dancing. So, like, I'm just so smooth on start with him.
Precious time for me on this Sunday evening. The art of cross-examination. In this day and age, when evidence is normally being recorded in the confines of the chambers of a commissioner, and very rarely do we get the chance of finally arguing a matter before the honorable judge who actually recorded evidence, it should be the lost art of cross-examination. Increasingly, and I find that quite disturbing, even during final arguments, in complex commercial disputes, civil suits, arbitrations, very cursory reference, if at all, is made to the evidence led by the parties, including key and material witnesses. Cross-examination is not a redundant thing. It is not an empty formality. It is a very powerful tool in the gathering and assisting of the Honorable Court in the appreciation of evidence. The art of cross-examination, and I say it's an art, because no straitjacket formula, no mathematical rationale can be applied to it. It's an art to deal with men and women and their minds and their psyches. It's an art used to play mind games with witnesses, to lay down traps and to secure the traps when the unsuspecting witness has fallen into it. So, my friends, cross-examination is in the domain of the artful lawyer. somebody who doesn't think very straight, and certainly not the linear-minded scientific of our fraternity. Let me make it very clear at the outset that for lawyers, and I'm dealing with lawyers, the object of the cross-examination is not to arrive at the truth. Arriving at the truth is the business of those who are in the adjudicatory capacity, the honorable judges, arbitrators, etc. The object of cross-examination, to my mind, is to skillfully put questions to the witness, the answers to which will convince the judge that the witness is being economical with the truth. It is certainly the business of the crafty cross-examiner to make the most truthful witness appear to the judge as being a rank liar. The object of the cross-examination is to advance the case of your client and to destroy, shake, or dilute the testimony of the witness who's deposed against him. So in this background, I am reminded of a quote by the legendary jurist lawyer, Mr. Paul Brown. On the general rules a lawyer must employ while cross-examining a witness. And witnesses are of various hues and colors, of varying intellect, capacities, of different sets of moralities, of different strengths of character and minds. So, as Paul Brown said, be mild with the mild, shrewd with the crafty, confiding with the honest, merciful to the young, the frail or the fearful, rough to the ruffian, and the thunderbolt to the liar. Bring to bear all powers of your mind, not that you may shine, but that virtually may triumph and your cause may prosper. The clients love, absolutely, no matter what the outcome of the case is, they are very happy with you if you insult the adversary or as witness as the case may be. Here you must be very wary. The object of cross-examination is not to insult or to intimidate or to dominate the witness. The object of the cross-examination, and you may please note the three main objects of the cross-examination, is primarily to elicit from an adverse witness something in your favor. A witness has been called by the other side. He is primarily called with the object of deposing against you. His examination in chief is adverse to your client. But skillful and an artful cross-examiner will make the witness, by the crafty questions that he puts to him at the right time, say something which is in favor of your client's case. There's no point giving illustrations in these because illustrations can go on and on. There will be no end to it. But as a general rule, the second object is to destroy, weaken, or dilute the force of what the witness has deposed against him. Assertions of fact have been made against him. in the examination in chief, categorical assertions, which if they are unrebutted, unweakened, undiluted, which will harm the interests of your client, you have to put questions with a view to dilute those assertions and depositions made against you. The third object of cross-examination is to show from the cross-examination you elicit from the witness that his present demeanor or his past conduct is such that he is not credible and he is unworthy of being believed. If you can't achieve it in totality, the cross-examination should be enough to cast a doubt in the mind of the judge as to the creditworthiness of that witness, so that every statement made is taken with a pinch of salt while the judgment is being written. Not to make it too academic, but since we are at the topic, we will do well to read a few sections from the Indian Evidence Act. Before you embark upon the exercise of cross-examination or indeed recording of evidence, you must be thorough with the rules of your procedure, be it the CRPC or the Code of Civil Procedure, and also the Evidence Act. Now, if you read with me, Section 137, which deals with examination in chief and cross-examination and re-examination. And may I read, if you have the benefit of having the Evidence Act before you, physically or on your screens, you can read it with me. Otherwise, I will read it for your benefit. The examination of a witness by the party who calls him shall be called as examination in chief. In civil cases now, the facility of having examinations in chief on affidavits, which are pre-drafted, is there. Then it says cross-examination, the examination of a witness by the adverse party shall be called his cross-examination. Re-examination, the examination of a witness subsequent to the cross-examination by a party who calls him shall be his re-examination. And then there is another opportunity of cross-examination confined to the statement made and not going beyond the statements made in the re-examination. Now, 138 is the order of examination, which is first chief, then cross, then re-examination, and then cross and re-examination. 139 is the witness who is called to produce a document, is a mere carrier of that document and shall not be cross-examined. A person summoned to produce a document does not become a witness by the mere fact that he produces it and cannot be cross-examined unless and until he is called a witness. Then 140 says, witness to character may be cross-examined and re-examined. If somebody deposes adversely against the character of your client or any of his witnesses, he certainly can be cross-examined by you. Leading questions. 141 defines leading questions, and there might be some ambiguity in certain minds as regard what leading questions is and what is the scope of leading questions. Leading questions are any questions suggesting the answer which the person putting it wishes or expects to receive is called a leading question. Were you there on 10 Akbar Road at 6 p.m. on 24th of May? When this question is asked, the suggested answer is inbuilt. Leading questions by virtue of 142 of the Evidence Act cannot be asked in examinations in chief. So the cross-examining counsel, before his turn comes, must be very alert as to whether the question is leading and must object at the right stage, the moment the question is asked and before the witness has answered the question. Leading questions are certainly permitted in cross-examinations, and they are, in my experience, very potent tools of a cross-examining lawyer. So what may be asked are leading questions, questions which suggest answers, suggestions which is primarily the case of the other side, which is being put to the witness. Though in civil cases now there are judgments, and one in particular by Honorable Mr. Justice Rajiv Sahay Endlaw, which says that as opposed to criminal cases, civil cases, the stand of the various parties is very clear from the pleadings, and therefore there is no requirement of putting suggestions. But there are case laws to the contrary as well. So but suggestions can be put, leading questions can be put. The witnesses can be confronted with previous statements in writing of that very witness, even though they might not be a part of record of that very case. But if it's a previous statement in writing, certainly it can be put to the witness under cross-examination. Questions to test the veracity of not only the witness, but also of his testimony in chief. Questions which are intended to discover who the witness is and what is his station in life. The background of a witness, the educational qualifications, the literacy level are all questions which are relevant and must be asked before, and I call them the know your customer questions. Because not only does it enlighten the court as to what the witness is all about, it also gives you an idea of the capacity of the witness to answer your questions. Is the witness straightforward? Is the witness mentally not so agile? Is the witness unprepared? Is the witness rather well prepared? If the witness is clever, if the witness is intelligent, and more importantly, if the witness is truthful or lying. These questions must be put so that you have a fair idea of what you're dealing with. § 146(3) of the Evidence Act is a very curious question, curious section rather, because you know all these American TV shows about lawyers, witnesses normally just put up their hand and plead the Fifth Amendment and refusing to answer questions which in their assessment incriminate them. But that's something which is very interesting in the Indian law. If you kindly have 146 of the Evidence Act. When a witness is cross-examined, he may, in addition to the questions herein before referred to, be asked any questions which tend, 3, to shake his credit by injuring his character, though the answers to such questions might tend directly or indirectly to criminate him, or might expose him to tend directly or indirectly to expose him to a penalty or forfeiture. And there is a proviso which exempts the witness from answering such questions if the offense leads to prosecution under Section 376A or POXO or such other sensitive matters. And this takes us back to 132. 132 makes it very clear that a witness shall not be excused. And I emphasize here, a witness shall not be excused from answering any question as to the matter relevant to the matter in issue in any suit or any civil or criminal proceeding upon the ground that such answer to such questions will criminate or may tend directly or indirectly to criminate such witness, or that it will expose or tend directly or indirectly to expose such witness to a penalty or forfeiture of any kind. So if I ask a witness as to whether he, by employing method X or Y, evaded tax, the witness cannot say that I plead the Fifth Amendment and I refuse to answer this question because it might incriminate me and make me liable for income tax action. read with 132 and 148, and I'll read 148 for the benefit. If any such question relates to a matter not relevant to the suit proceeding, except insofar as it affects the credit of the witness by injuring his character, the court shall decide whether or not the witness shall be compelled to answer it, and may, if it thinks fit, warn the witness he might is not obliged to answer it. In exercising the discretion, the court shall have regard to the following considerations, which are enlisted in subsections 1 to 4 of section 148. So 132 says that you will not refuse to answer on the ground that it might incriminate you. 148 says that if it is not directly relevant to the cross-examination or the suit, then subject to these conditions, the court may warn the witness that it might incriminate you and you have an option of not answering it. That's a limited scope of prohibition. Otherwise, as a general rule, if it is relevant to the controversy at hand, the judge will compel the witness to answer questions, notwithstanding the fact that they will incriminate him in some other proceedings to any penalty or forfeiture, etc. What may not be asked? I'm sorry, there's some problem with the Instagram live feeding. It's not connecting. So just give me a minute. I'll just be back. Yes, so I am back. Sorry for the glitch. What may be asked? The cross-examination is not confined to the examination in chief. It is not confined to the affidavit by way of examination in chief. So please do not restrict yourself while cross-examining by saying that, you know, the witness has not said this in examination in chief and how can I ask that question? That is not the law. So you can ask questions which are not coming out directly from the examination in chief. Indecent and scandalous questions are not permitted. You will not ask questions which will either scandalize the court or embarrass the witness or be indecent in any manner. Those questions are certainly not prohibited. Questions which are intended to insult or annoy are prohibited from being asked. But there is a very thin line, according to me, between questions which are intended to insult or annoy and questions which are actually designed to shake the veracity, the credibility of the witness. And that is where the role of the judge comes into play. A very famous and old example of this is that the solicitor on relevant considerations and on factual input instructs the barrister that the witness is actually a dacoit. Because the answer would shake the credibility of the witness in the eyes of the judge, the barrister is perfectly within his domain to ask the question on instructions and with credible evidence to back it up that the witness is in fact a dacoit. To the contrary, only to shake the witness, to make him angry, or with any other ulterior motive, randomly the barrister gets up and says, Mr. X, you are a dacoit, I put it to you that you have done numerous dacoities in the past, without any basis at all, that question will certainly be a question which is intended to insult and annoy the witness and which will be prohibited by the court. And as a prudent cross-examination, cross-examiner, whose duty is also towards the court, you will cease and desist from asking such questions, which are statutorily prohibited as well. 154 of the Evidence Act deals with the situation where the witness goes hostile, meaning thereby that the witness, I call a witness as my witness, and while the examination in chief is on, or even thereafter during cross-examination, the witness starts deposing contrary to the interest of the party who summoned him into the witness box. In which cases, the party who has summoned such a witness into the witness box is fully entitled to put questions which are in the nature of cross-examination to such a witness. And that power, that entitlement flows from Section 154 of the Evidence Act. Like I said in the beginning, it's a very, very vast field. And I have seen this very, in fact, I must share it with you, disturbing trend in some books on cross-examination, which prescribe model questions of cross-examination. Now, every case has different set of facts. Cross-examination is all about facts. Every case has its different factual matrix. Every case has its own dynamics. So, preparing a cross-examination by reading those model questions and in fact modeling a cross-examination on them, according to me, may not be the best advocacy practice. It is worrying that many books have now become so dependent on precedents and formats that they have started giving model questions of murder cases, model questions of engineering arbitrations, as if there are cases which are factually identical. And these model questions are some kind of broad spectrum antibiotics which can be applied anywhere. So, golden rules of practical cross-examination. There were times and people used to take pride in that, not anymore, in doing spontaneous cross-examinations. Perhaps in some criminal cases, to an extent, this can be done a fairly simplistic examination in chief, and the judge calls upon you to cross-examine. You may perhaps spontaneously cross-examine if you have the requisite experience of cross-examining witnesses. But in complex commercial suits, in civil suits, in arbitrations, in complex criminal trials, I would strongly advise against spontaneous cross-examinations. Prepare. Read the Evidence Act, the procedural rules. Read the examination in chief. Make questions, ponder over the answers which a witness might give. There will always be two sets of answers. Chart the course of action. If the witness answers X, chart the course of action if the witness answers Y. Must be prepared, thoroughly prepared, You should read all documents to the TruthCom, cross-referencing, and make copious notes. Memories have often failed men at crucial times. Secondly, it is very easy to answer. It's very easy to question. But it becomes very difficult to live with an answer after you've questioned. So think twice before putting a question. Assess the witness. Do I ask him? What will he answer? Thirdly, don't recklessly put questions to a witness without realizing the implications of these questions. Strong cases have been known to be lost because of reckless and excessive cross-examinations. So don't recklessly put questions to the witness. Ponder over them, think twice before putting a question, and be prepared for an answer which you are not expecting. And then frame your next question accordingly. Don't play to the galleries. Must not lose sight of the fact that cross-examination is not your theatrical performance. It is a tool to prove your client's case and to disprove the adversary's case, to demolish the testimony of the witness under cross-examination. It is not as if you're performing in a theater before a live audience, so stop playing to the galleries. The judges don't like it for sure, I know. And you also, by doing that, make the witness attentive, alert, and wary of the questions, which is certainly not going to work to your client's advantage. As I said earlier, don't insult the witness. It does not harmonize with our noble profession, A. It is statutorily prohibited, B. And C, it puts you in a very bad light before the judge. Another golden rule is that you must not, and I repeat, and I, this is something which is of great importance, which I, very crafty cross-examiner from Guwahati, who was leading me in a matter in 2000, Mr. Niloy Anand Datta, took pains to explain to me that never ask a question the answer of which you don't know. Don't go into a fishing, roving inquiry. You must answer a question the answer of which you know yourself. Because if you don't know and you recklessly put that question to the witness, the answer, howsoever false it may be, will stick to you and harm your interests. Another thing which I have learned from experience is that don't ask a question to which the witness lies. If you don't have any material to confront him with the lie and expose him. Because then that lie will stick on record as the truth. Unless the question is so material that it is, you are running the risk of an observation judgment that no questions are put on this point. As a general rule, if you can't prove that the witness has given an untruthful answer, the question is better not asked. Or if it is to be asked, it is asked in a manner akin to a suggestion. Never lose eye contact with the witness. The witness's eyes and his tone and his voice will instinctively tell an astute cross-examiner as to whether the witness is lying, is being truthful, or is being economical with the truth. Never lose eye contact with the witness. Be attentive to him. And more often than not, be polite to him. Be humble in your questions. Lull him into getting a false sense of confidence and security. Ask him questions, present yourself in a demeanor whereby he dulls his guard, he becomes comfortable. It is then when your witness will start singing. Next golden rule is, unless absolutely essential, don't ask too many questions, limit your cross-examination, make it brief. If you realize that the witness is a clever witness, an intelligent witness who is well prepared with his case and knows what he's talking about. Such witnesses are dangerous because they will prove their case in the examination in chief and end up reaffirming their case in the cross-examination, which will add to the extreme prejudice of your client. So, if you find that the witness is very well prepared, he is by and large truthful, well prepared with the case, and is a man of sound intelligence who can instinctively know where your line of cross-examination is leading, it is better to be brief in your questions and not make it an extensive, prolonged cross-examination. Another thing one must be very cautious about is, once you get an admission, there are times, and we are all human and we fall prey to it, the best of us, once you get an admission, you extract an admission, don't rub it in. Leave it there and go to the next topic, change tracks. Because a witness invariably realizes that he has admitted to something which he ought not to have. And prolonged questioning on that line of questions after you have extracted the admission will make the witness say something which will dilute the admission. So once you get an admission, close that suitcase there and there and scoot. Go to the next topic. Don't rub it in. All of us have this tendency of asking just one question too many, even after we've gotten admission in our favor. Last but not the least, or generally a man prone to be rude or annoying in his behavior, don't lose your temper, because the moment you do that, the quality of your cross-examination will go for a toss and it will become impossible for you to objectively in the best interest of your client to continue with the cross examination. With that, my friends, I think in the limited time that I have, and I know interest spans are also very short these days, and the fact is that it's an endless topic, this business. I end my talk with you. Thank you so much for listening in. And cross-examinations can never be perfected by the aid of books or by the aid of learnt by practical experience, by conducting them. And sorry for saying this, but at the cost of your clients. So have a good Sunday. I welcome any questions that you may kindly put to me. Thank you very much. It was very nice being with you. Just call up Ms. Janvi Sharma and ask her how to.
Yeah. See, there are any questions?
It's a very poor connection. Are being put to me. Okay, I see Aditi 17 Divine. I know due to technical issues you were unable to get clarification. What exactly do you want me to repeat about what question? What topic do you want me to repeat? So I guess there are no questions. Ladies and gentlemen, it was a pleasure. Thank you very much. And I must thank Lawyers Wit for giving me this opportunity of saying these few words on the art of cross-examination before a very august gathering. Thank you very much all. There is a question from Mr. Hemant Mishra. It so happens that in some situations the judge interferes by way of giving inputs during the course of examination. How to deal with such a situation? I know that's a very unpleasant thing, Hemant. Judges are known to do that, and unwittingly though, they end up disturbing your line of questions and making the witness wiser. You must very firmly tell the judge as to yes, there is a method in my madness. I'm asking all relevant questions. Please let me just examine the witness in the manner that I deem fit. And if the judge persists, you please stop the cross-examination and please request the judge to let the witness leave the courtroom. And then you politely and firmly explain to the judge as to what your line of cross-examination is and where it will be leading. So this is what it is, Hemant. Unfortunate, judges should be very passive spectators when there is a cross-examination happening, and they should actually ordinarily intervene only when something prohibited is being asked. But they are humans, and sometimes they do put in their two words, which acts to the prejudice of the cross-examination of the cross-examiner. Tanya Tamanna has sent a question. Can you enlighten about the suggestion that we should put to make our case strong? Suggestions are basically questions which are in the nature of putting your case to that witness. I put it to you that you are not entitled to deduct any liquidated damages. I put it to you that the deposition in paragraph so and so of examination chief is false for the reason this. These are basically suggestions. There are no straitjacket formula. Depends on case to case basis and on the facts of the particular case which you are dealing with. But according to me, and I know there are judgments which are not in line with the what my humble and irrelevant opinion is, even in civil cases, suggestions are of necessity. And after asking 4 or 5 questions on that line, and if you've secured something in your favor, you must end it up with a suggestion. Any other questions?
Just check your Instagram.
Case law, Aditi, case law again, it's a completely factual thing. You will find case laws on every aspect of cross-examination. You will find case laws on what is permissible to confront the witness with. You will find case laws on what is insulting and annoying questions. You will find case law on leading questions. So do research, you will find everything. There are no general case law on cross-examination. One general thing which you will find certainly is that a witness whose examination in chief is untested by cross-examination, that examination in chief is not worth the paper it is written on, and it has to be necessarily discarded. You will also find case law on when does the right of a co-defendant or a co-accused to examine a witness of the co-defendant or the co-accused, cross-examine the defendant of the witness of a co-defendant or co-accused arise. So you will find case law on every aspect of cross-examination and recording of statements of witnesses. Like I said, it's a case-to-case factual thing, so there is no general case law on this. So that seems to be it. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. It was a pleasure. End.